In this video, we are doing a deep dive on technical analysis. We're talking about Elliott Wave. We're talking about Fibonacci retracements. How do you use them on how you can analyze the markets and trade the markets with confidence? So if you want to know more about Elliott Wave and Fibonacci, you have to check this video out. Hey guys, so we are back once again for another technical analysis deep dive. But for this video, we have a very special guest and we have him for a two-part series. In this video, he's gonna talk about drill down, his specialty, his favorite technical analysis parameter, which happens to be the Elliott Wave. As you all know, there's a lot of subjectivity when it comes to analyzing the Elliott Wave. And while we were doing the interview, I got a lot of insights and it helped me also on a personal level learn more about the Elliott Wave. Without much ado, we have Jonathan Ravelas, Chief Market Strategist of BDO, in the podcast. And what's so interesting is, you know what I've been trying to say, technical analysis, investing in the stock market, it's all about not just deploying capital, but also experience. He has over 20 plus years of experience in the markets, which is more than double the time that I have been investing in the markets altogether. I hope that you get a lot from him, and I hope that while he's speaking, you have your notes lined up, that you're writing, and that you are understanding everything that he is saying. So if you guys are ready, comment, I'm ready, comment, I'm excited. Hi everyone, so we're in for a treat today. We have Jonathan Ravelas, Chief Market Strategist of BDO, and in my opinion, one of the relatively good technicians in the market right now, and we're gonna tickle his brain and talk about his expertise also in trading the market. So how are you? How's everything?
It's very difficult and challenging time. So despite being in the market for more than 20 years, again, the present situation is something different, no? And it's something that makes me tick, no? The nice thing about dealing with financial markets, it's basically, it's always different every day. Mm-hmm. So it's not boring. So you get to learn a lot of things. Diba? Yeah. Kahit alam mo na yung mga principles that you're looking at, and suddenly you're challenged of new things. So how do you respond? No?
Got it. I'm so curious, being in the markets for more than 20 plus years, is there a discipline in technical analysis, or at least a parameter, an indicator that you've seen that's been better off compared to others, at least from your own personal experience?
I started my love affair with the stock market since I was in college.
No? Whoa, okay.
So eventually, I actually studied and helped a friend who was eventually doing a computer-aided technical analysis. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So anyway, what we did was basically to study all the potential studies in technical analysis. There are over 400, and I believe now there are over 600. No? But I guess in the early 1990s, fundamentals and technicals were always separated. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nobody wanted to, you know, if you stick to fundamentals, you stick to fundamentals. If you go for technicals, then just stick to technicals. Okay. The problem starting off was basically you can't have, there should always be both fundamental and technical. There are both good and bad things about each other. No? So if the fundamentals tells you what are those that are, that's giving you values, what's there, is it something that is there a tangible asset that I can hold in that company or none? No? So you need those if you're really trading, so you know that there is the potential trend that you're following has bearing or has momentum, no? And it's not all talk. I tried over time to check so many indicators and I only fell in love with one, and that's Elliott Wave.
Oh, okay.
Because it's consistent. Now, Elliott Wave basically allows you to understand the developments in the economy. At the same time, look at it from a perspective of growth and decay. So how do you do that? Now, when I started off as a stockbroker for DBS Securities, I was just doing the equity markets. Eventually, my stint in the equity markets did not last long, mainly because of the Asian financial crisis. It led me to the 10th largest lender, which is at that time Equitable Bank, which is now eventually BDO. No? So eventually, that gave me a parameter for looking at foreign exchange, the fixed income market. So that gave me a total feel of the financial markets. So it's actually trying to, you can't just concentrate on the equity market without looking at the economy, looking at the foreign exchange. So you need to look at all of this from a 360 perspective. So you need to be able to balance all of them. No? So now, when you talk about growth, most of that is going to be seen in the equity market, while the decay is actually seen in the currency markets. There seems to be a balance. And right now, it helps you one person to look at the wave details so that one can see how the market is eventually unfolding.
For a lot of people who have been studying Elliott Wave, they're struggling between the subjectivity. Saan mo pa-plot yung first wave? How do you know that this is actually the third wave, or it's just part of an even bigger wave as well?
I look at the fundamentals first, no? So I try to come up with what's gonna drive the market higher. So I try to put what fundamentals will drive it up. And at the same time, I will also put the drivers that will eventually bring it down. When we try to look at the chart, it now tells you a balance of where the potential probabilities are. So like the chart in front of you, this is as of August 4. No? So I normally try to print it normally slightly. I only print a chart once or twice a month. Eh? So here, you're looking at the bullish and bearish trend. This is where I try to bring down now my count. No, I come up with a preferred count that I think where the market is going. So the recent low is 4039.15. No? So it tells me that my expectation is still that there is still room to go down. Mm-hmm. You'll notice that I have a stop loss here, which is at 6923, masyadong mataas pa. And if I'm expecting the market to have ended in, which is my alternate count, which is a bullish count, is that it already ended at 4039. The market should be able to go back to around 5.8. So eventually, this was already exceeded. But now we're at the 5.8 level again. No? That's why my preferred is still looking at a target of probably between 4.5 to 5.384 in the near term. So just to show you the long-term count of the Philippines and the chart that is in front of you, the market is eventually broken down into five waves. So the five waves is multi-year. So it takes a lot of practice to eventually try to understand the potential turnaround in certain situations. But to make it easier for your readers and to your listeners, every turning point normally corresponds to a very important event. Mm. Now, typically, it is mostly driven by a good fundamental issue. So it could be an upgrade. If you remember, in February of 2018, we were at the height of build, build, build. So the growth numbers of the Philippines continued to rise, di ba? So it shows that the inherent strength of the Philippine economy. But eventually after that, we had a series of unfortunate events which were primarily driven by the delays in the build, build, build as the passage of the 2019 budget, di ba? To a certain extent, we had a series of delays of new projects that were eventually mandated by government. Akala natin mabilis kasi sila na yung gagastos, di ba?
Yes.
And there is what people call the absorptive capacity of government. So even though you have the money, but you don't have the resources like people to start it off, it's useless. So eventually, you had the impact of the trade war. And then, of course, the recent one is COVID. Now, if you tend to look at the expectation that this could be a wave four, pay attention to the Roman numerals. Kasi ito yung trend na tinitingnan natin na medyo long term. So remember that this is from 2009 to around 2018. That's the whole third wave. And normally, ito yung pinakamalaki.
Hmm.
So we're now at the point that we could be finishing a wave four. And there should be a wave five. Now, the key question is the recent low at 40.39 the valid low?
Hmm.
So in my previous slide, the confirmation of that is a break above 6.9.
Hmm.
Or at least, if you were to ride the trend, then at least an initial break of 6.3 should be mm-hmm. a good number.
Mm-hmm.
No? But we haven't reached that level. Eh?
Okay.
So right now, we're marred by a lot of uncertainties. So to me, using Elliott gives me a potential turnaround of events of what could happen.
Mm-hmm.
No? So of course, this is the long-term count, no? So ngayon, meron naman ako medium term. So you eventually try to gauge. That's why we're saying that in my weekly commentaries, I'm just looking at 5,700 to 6,000 as a range.
Mm-hmm.
So until such time that there are potential reasons that could eventually trigger a potential reversal on the upside. So sa akin, that's how simple my strategy is in trying to analyze the market. I try to look at what will be the drivers that will eventually turn the market to a sustainable movement, whether up or down. So if we were to go back to what's happening in the market and we're seeing the momentum going down, then the risks to the downside, I will try to look for that fundamentals that will bring it lower. Or if I am a very bullish person, if I've loaded up, I will look at a position where what would be the triggers that will reverse the situation. Huh? So typically traders, and this is a common practice, they don't want to look at the other side. People always look at supporting their positions. So that's the challenge for any trader. Sometimes you need to be able to show that you're willing to look at the negative points of your trade even before you've entered your trade. So kailangan meron ka ng stop loss ahead of time.
When you plotted that we were on wave 4 for the longer chart time frame, would you suggest that since it's not yet on a specific reversal upward, it would be prudent for more people to just stay in cash, particularly that wala pa talaga yung either the fundamental reason that it would start to push up already?
So as you know, inflation was around 2.4 to 2.5%. At 2.4%, and if you tend to look at where interest rates are today, they're practically much lower. Now, 3-month rates are below 2.3%. So, you're not earning money if you keep your money in cash. Diba? But there are stocks in the stock market that will give you dividend yields. And during this time, these are eventually good opportunities to load up on those potential stocks that have good dividend yields, no? So they're very easy to spot, no? And they're basically either telcos, they're basically consumer stocks, and eventually to a certain extent, banks that would eventually give dividends, no? Of course, now that their prices are so low, relative to their potential dividends, they're technically going to give you at least close to 5% per year. So that makes stocks more attractive today than bonds because of the low interest rate scenario. The problem is it's your holding power. Diba? How long are you willing to hold? Diba? So if we were to put it in a perspective, when do you start buying? When it's on a sale or when it's regular price? Diba? So like the stock market today is practically down by more than 23%. No? So basically, the stock market is in a mega sale. So you want to be able to take advantage of this situation. The question is your holding power. It really depends on you. Are you willing to be a long-term investor or are you just going to be a trader? In a situation such as ours, when there's still uncertainty, dyan mo makikita kung meron kang nerves of steel. If you have the holding power, then I suggest you buy the stock and just forget about it for the next 2 to 3 years. If I am a trader, if I make more than 10-15%, then I should be taking out my position. That's why you have to identify which trader are you. Are you the long-term player or the trader?
There's so much debate on how people would decide. So for example, people would plot support and resistances regardless of how they use it. They could use it via Fibonacci moving averages or plotting their own support and resistance. In your practice and in your experience, how do you do it when a stock hits a certain support range? Do you buy exactly at the bounce from support or do you wait for other candlesticks as confirmation to start coming in? And then in connection to that, secondly, how do you suggest people should tranche up or tranche their buying once a stock hits a certain support level?
The way I determine my support and resistance levels are basically more subjective on my part, mainly because I would look at the Fibonacci ratios. But what is more important is looking at a historical perspective. So as long as I look at the historical chart and I would see a certain support level being tested 3 to 5 times or more, then that is an important support that I will remember. So hindi lang na-compute yan, support ko na yan. I will look at the historical. So I will take more time in understanding the stock itself. So literally, it's a characteristic of an individual stock that you want to look at. Not just it's mechanically driven by a system. You want to look at a historical approach. Second, it's just a question of conviction. Normally, if you are really convicted, you want to eventually buy as much as 30 to 50% of what you want at the onset. If the market goes down, then you want to buy maybe half or one third. If you're very conservative, then split your trade into three. So if you think that the market will still adjust lower, then buy two thirds when the market corrects. Let's say I'm buying 10,000. I can buy 4,000 now. And when the market corrects, I'll buy the 6,000. And maybe that can be a 10 to 20% differential in price.
Just curious about it, when you say correct, do you automatically buy it just because it's lower than the first support range that you bought it? Or you wait for it again to hit the next support before you start loading up on the next position?
Normally, what I would do if there's from a certain rebound, I would actually look at a 32 to 50% as my buying window. If I'm going to use a retracement level to eventually enter a position. So I will look at that range that I feel comfortable. So which means I am already computing it from a resistance that is computed based on support computed from a Fibonacci system and eventually looking at historical lows or supports to help me determine those price points. Now, if I see that volume is eventually ending and I am not much, I'm willing to bite the bullet. Because you have to understand it's difficult to buy near the lows. It's really by chance that you get to buy near the lows. It's difficult to say, oh, I sold at the top and bought at the bottom. Mm. Siyempre, you have to look at it from an average perspective. No? So, even the high of 2018, I think it took us 3 weeks before we called it a top.
When people start practicing Fibonacci, connecting the lowest point to the highest point, and then the lines start to progress, a lot of people have been saying there's a lot of subjectivity there. The longer you plot the lowest point and the highest point, the distance from each of the levels are too big already that it may take a longer time before it goes back to the next resistance or the next support.
Yes.
Have you seen, is there an optimal time frame okay. that you would say I could use this to connect the lows and the highs together?
Typically, Fibonacci ratios are best suited with Elliott waves. Hmm. So, in terms of Elliott waves, it is the mathematical dimension of Elliott wave. So, if Elliott wave believed that that is God's footprint, Fibonacci is actually God's footprint. So, technically, you'll need to understand that there is a golden ratio. So, if we are created by God, then definitely even the stock market are subject to this golden ratio, whether the market corrects by 38.2 or 61.8%. Diba? So, typically, I will eventually plot it against an Elliott wave count. So, if I were to, again, show you the chart, you will notice that I will connect my correction from this bottom to this top. Then, I will use my Fibonacci. And roughly, this is a 61.8%, slightly below 61.8%. Okay? So, for a wave 2, the typical correction is a, so to speak, a 61.8%. For a wave 3, that is typically 1.618% of wave 1. So, if this is 100%, this should at least be 1.618% of the whole wave 1. That's where I tend to use my ratio. Now, if I were to compute for a ratio of wave 4, then it should be at the beginning of this low to this. And a 50% of that will more or less drive us to this line here. So it will give you a 5.3, 61.8, and 0.76, which is 3,429. So the recent low is at 4,039. It is neither 61.8% nor it is to the next Fibonacci, which is at 0.76. So technically, that 4,000 is in limbo. And normally, in previous observations, the typical market will be able to see it closer to that number. But 4,500 and 4,000 is different. Eh. So, ibig sabihin, pwedeng mas mababa pa. That is something that, again, as an analyst, you have to prepare. Most of the traders, especially when you're in the retail ones, has this feel that they're strong. No? That means they can never lose. The first step of being a portfolio manager is not making money. It's about preserving capital. I try to break down my buying into three. So I buy roughly 33% or 30% at first. Then the rest, I will buy when the market goes down. What's important, I have a holding if the market goes up.
I have a question on top of that. The first context was you buy it, it starts to slide down. What if it does the opposite and it starts to break out? What are your rules naman to buy higher? Or since it's already started to go higher, you just stick with your initial position and you don't load up already on the next ones?
Buy on the first resistance. So when you buy on the break of that, it will close above that resistance. Now, if there it is combined with volume, then that's the time you do a breakout artist. So you buy already. So that is eventually the better strategy. So be a breakout artist. So eventually, if you're going to protect yourself, if you're a trader, then you will protect it on the low of the breakout. Doon ka magka-cut loss kung gusto mo mag-trade. Either you hold on to your position and wait it out, or if the market creates what people call pullback, when the market goes down below that resistance, some people will either buy. And again, what is important is what if it is on the upside, then kasi you have to also think of your time. So it's either you don't look at the strategy. Are you looking at a 1 to 3 week trade, or are you looking at 1 to 3 months na trade? So if you're looking at 1 to 3 months, then you don't need to do a stop loss, because most likely in a 1 to 3 months, there will be activity.
Follow-up question. You mentioned two interesting things. Breakout with volume. And I've talked to so many people that term breakout with volume has been so subjective. In your opinion, considering just the Philippine markets, what's considered a good value turnover that this breakout is something that we can regard as a good volume already?
It's very difficult to probably highlight, because if from my perspective, as long as you're trading above 50 to 75 million pesos, which is the typical liquidity of the market, anything higher than 20% of that should be a good set of volume. The problem in the Philippines is that we have selected stocks that are actually not really moving, di ba? So, meron lang siyang biglang sudden surge. So typically, what some people would do is that it has to be bigger, 1 to 2 times bigger than the average 3 month daily volume. So yun lang yung gagamitin mo na gauge. So you always try to average the last 3 months of the market activity. So if it goes beyond that, baka mayroong activity na. That's another way of looking, especially when you're trading a thin market like the Philippines. It's very difficult, I guess, for to look into stocks that are widely traded, which is the index, so you know that there is liquidity. But of course, there are certain growth stocks and some speculative stocks that will move at a moment's notice, no? And probably the typical volume for this type of trades normally is around 20 million. So if anything above 20 million than the previous day, then baka kasi the first step, mag-breakout. That's why it's always key that the potential breakout is a close above the resistance. At least maybe 10% to 20% above the closing price is ideal.
You mentioned people who are trading at least 1 to 3 months. They bought initially for support, then it started to break out. Then as it started to break out naman, 2 candlesticks, 3 candlesticks right after that, it started to drop again. Do you suggest that they get out of the position already? Or since they have an initial holding naman and then their time frame is longer, they should just stick to what they place and just hold?
It actually depends. If you are again normally when I enter a trade, I will always put a stop loss. Now for some, in that situation, you might want a trailing stop, which means they reevaluate their whole position, including what they had, and then they can just sell it off. Let me put it this way in a much simpler strategy. When in doubt, pull out.
That's a good
when you feel that it's also a very good population control strategy. When in doubt, pull out. So that is actually a good thing to look at, mainly because if you are having doubts to that rally, because that's actually what you're trying to say, there is fear. Diba? So if I've already entered a position which is much lower and I added, I will reevaluate. If what if I sell all, do I still make money? Now the key question is the trend that you are actually evaluating is has a trend line that is steeper than 45 degrees. Because different. A typical healthy market is at 45, diba? Just like any aircraft, when they take off, it's at 45 degrees. Anything above 45 is dangerous, mainly because your airplane will stall and you eventually will crash to the ground. So a 45 degree healthy trend line should always be your friend. Now, if it is very steep, then you might want to take it out altogether. Medyo nawawalan ka ng support dun sa stock mo or you're doubting yourself.
Is it dependent kung saan siya nang galing? Meaning, what if prior to that large above 45% swing, it came from a very, very long consolidation? Is it more valid kasi matagal siya nag-consolidate and the upward move is more than 45? Or if galing siya sa downtrend, then it just started to reverse, then above 45, that is there a comparison that if it was a long consolidation naman, baka it does the above 45% swing is justified or it applies to all?
It depends upon the characteristic. Each stock has its own characteristics. That's why what I do is I try to keep my universe quite small. I would probably trade between 5 at the most. 3 is ideal. I only have 3 investment mantras. The first is I will invest in an asset that will appreciate over time. Okay? So this could be a stock, it could be a bond. The other one is invest in assets that will provide recurring income. And earlier, that's basically stocks that gives you dividends. Diba? So you can also buy real estate and have it rented. There are so many things. The third is basically something that's speculative. So you're either looking for the next SM, the next BDO, the next pure gold. But the most important in investment is time. So you must have the time to hold any of these stocks. So yan yung key. So it really depends on your time frame. If you don't have a time frame in mind and you feel that things have changed. And for me, if there is a long-term consolidation and suddenly the stock moves, that's a good, you know, I would rather maybe hold on to it for a while. You mentioned, going back to your example, no? Nakabili na tayo, umakyat, then biglang bumaba. Maybe it's just consolidating for another rally. Then I'll hold. Now, if I will look for a position where maybe I'll give it a number of time before I reevaluate. Kasi pwede mag-congestion ulit, no? And, you know, it's just an aberration. If there is no fundamentals to support it, then that's the time I will probably entertain selling it if I don't find any fundamental to support any rally.
I hope you guys got a lot from this video. If you have any questions, feel free to put them on the comment section below. And what's so interesting about today is that it was such a fresh perspective on how the Elliott Wave gets analyzed and how you get to sync it with the Fibonacci retracement in terms of plotting and making your buy and sell signals. By the way, if you're new to this channel, my name is Marvin Gurman, a stock market trader and investor. And if you want daily content on trading the markets using technical or fundamental analysis, like, share, subscribe, and smash the bell so you get updated every time I come up with new content about investing. Now, in the next video with Jonathan Ravelas, which is happening 2 days from now, he's gonna explain what's happening on the markets. Why is the market having a hard time to go up? Is there something that's concerning? And what are the things that you need to look at to see how or when the market will reverse? So here are some snippets of the video And I hope this video helps you trade well, trade strong, trade smart. See you all again soon, guys, and God bless you all.
Confidence eventually is absent. Now, to move into the cycle of confidence in the markets, the confidence there must be on three things. One is confidence in government. Government in the sense on how we deal with this pandemic. So dealing with this pandemic means we need to think about more of prevention rather than reactionary, which is what we're doing. What we're doing is we are testing, we are tracing, and we are treating.